we perhaps, if you want to, be upstanding, we'll open the word and we'll sing a song. Lord, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. We'll say the Lord's Prayer. to say with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in the heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so upon the earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Now, please be seated. So before we begin to look at the virtue faithfulness, which there really is no other way to put it, but it's really the crown of all virtues. It touches every other virtue, and we'll see that today when we look closer at it. And of course, every virtue, when you look at it, inevitably we realize how valuable it is, because those virtues are glimpses of God. They're glimpses of God that we are seeking to bring into our life. But before we do that, I want to read a couple of passages and read a poem about New Church Day, because yesterday, as you know, was 250 years since New Church Day. And we think about the celebration or the birthday of the church. What is it? It means a lot of different things to people. We've often seen the image, we did last year, the image of the great red dragon being defeated. This year, I'd like to bring into your thoughts the idea of the rider on the horse, the white rider on the horse, the Lord himself, who is riding forth into your life to bring you greater peace, greater victory, to allow New Jerusalem to live and dwell inside of you. So reading from An Invitation to the New Church, paragraph 37, it says that the whole of the Lord's Prayer, from beginning to end, has respect to the present time, the time of the new church, the time of the Lord's New Jerusalem descending. It's all there in the Lord's Prayer. Thy will be done, as in heaven, so upon this earth, me, New Jerusalem descending. This is very plain. That is that God the Father is worshipped in human form. This appears if the prayer is rightly explained. So it's this idea of New Church Day, this idea of us coming into the visible God. God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ in our midst. Here is a poem by Evelyn Plummer. Some may know or may not. Brian, does that name? Evelyn Plummer. She was a close friend for 23 years to Mr. John Pitcairn. And she wrote this poem concerning New Church Day. June 19th. In song we hail the glorious morn that dawned in June, O deepest night. From God in heaven its rays newborn shone forth to fill the earth with light. No greater day has e'er unfurled its banners bright across the sky, a hope of life to dying world, the advent of the Lord Most High. The ransomed soul imprisoned long, the joyful hour of freedom come, released they rise with shout and song to praise the Lord Most Holy Name, and through that world with festival zeal, the 12 who followed him, O yore, glad tidings from their Lord reveal. The gospel that he reigns once more. And all the flaming heavens flash forth the glory of the living word, from east to west and south to north, declare the coming of the Lord. The seed is sown and men shall reap the harvest and its precious boon, while nations yet unborn shall keep with grateful hearts this day in June. Isn't that beautiful? I think she was born in 1837, somewhere around there. So that's kind of the time that was written. Beautiful, isn't it? Yeah, I just thought we'd pause. We'll do a full celebration of New Church Day at the family service. I just wanted to pause and acknowledge that New Church Day passed yesterday for us. And look at what's going on in the world. Think about that. New Church Day. Faithfulness. What exactly is this virtue of faithfulness? It holds something different to each one of us. We might think about being faithful in our marriage, but we'll look at that next abiding in the vine. We're going to look at fidelity, because faithfulness is so much more. And it's always good to remember each one of these virtues actually belong to the Lord and the Lord alone. And we're endeavoring to have them manifest in our life. There's the Lord's coming. So life has this way of throwing curveballs. Yeah? If you know baseball, I don't know, can they do curveballs in cricket? They can do a little bit of that, can't they? But you're there at the pad, you've got your bat, and you've learnt how to hit the balls that are coming at you. I've got this. And then comes the curveball. COVID-19 and everything that's followed. Or earlier in the year, it might have been the fires or the floods. These curveballs. We just start hitting them out of the court. And then comes the curveball. Fascinating, isn't it? I want you to think about what keeps you on course. What keeps you on course? What is it that's actually keeping you? We know it's the Lord, but what is it that's inside you that's keeping you on course? You wanted to say something? Don't know. It's the values that you carry, the virtues that you set up in your life as important. Because when life starts throwing curveballs and we're on automatic pilot, we tend to go into fight and flight, an automatic pilot. The brain takes over like it's meant to. It does its job. And what's its job? Keep you alive. But its primary coding or ruling says, in keeping you alive or survive, move towards pleasure, move away from pain. Now that's pretty good principle for staying alive, for survival. But it's a rotten principle for thrival, for thriving. Isn't it? It's not the way to spiritually thrive. Well, why would you say that? Because our values ask us to make sacrifices for a greater good. Our values call us to not go the easy way, but to choose a slightly harder way for a greater reward. Yeah? It's like investments. The greater the risk, the greater the return. But it's a risk. And so it's easy to go with the brain when life's throwing those curveballs. You run off the field. No. Because they're hitting you. No. Adjust. And that's what our values do. These virtues are about us adjusting. But they come primarily from the Lord. Let's look at faithfulness. Open up. I want you to take a moment. Tame your life. Take a moment examining your life. Think about the people. I've already covered the front end. Don't worry about it. Think about the people in your life who've been faithful to you. Who, because of their faithfulness, could be your parents, could be a partner, could be a teacher at school, could be a neighbor, because of their faithfulness to their values and principles, your life has been enriched. Your life's been enriched. What would your life look like if these people weren't faithful? In fact, what would your life look like if you weren't faithful in some situations? Let's jump straight to the card. Why not? We can do things a little differently. Grab your card. If you didn't have one, did you get one, everyone? I want to go to the card. Have a look. Faithfulness is the conviction to live according to one's inner core values. Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. What kind of love has God been faithful with? Everlasting. Well, how does that work? You know, when I think about fundamental Christianity, and they have this idea that God is faithful, like we do, but they've got to marry that up with the idea that if you haven't quite grabbed a hold of who Jesus is in this life, you're in trouble. How do they marry that up with God that's faithful? It must cause a lot of challenges and convictions. I'll address that too, because I'm going to talk about Dr. Mary Neal, who would say she's not a Christian until she died. She's come back and she's voraciously talking about Jesus and his love for her. We'll talk about that in a moment. Let's read this quote here. You're going to see here why, you know, what's really going on in the punishment of God. Jordan said to me this morning, Dad, what's your take on Sodom and Gomorrah? You know, they left and down, you know, hail and fire started raining on Sodom and Gomorrah. Well, it's answered here in this passage. Let's have a look. The same is also meant by the statement made in various places in the prophets to the effect that after the faithful have been brought back from captivity, so like Lot and his family taken out of Sodom, after they've been brought back from captivity, their enemies, who captivated them, kept them in prison, would undergo punishment and perish. This is constantly happening in the next life. That is to say, the faithful are saved first, and then the faithless are punished. Or, what amounts to the same thing? The former are first raised up into heaven by the Lord, and after that, the latter hurl themselves into hell. What's that passage saying to us? Does anyone want to jump out? What's the real key to that passage there? When it comes to punishment, is God really punishing?
No, it's what we do.
Right, it's what we do. Lives. It's what we do in our lives, yes.
Yeah.
That brings punishment.
Yeah.
Okay, when does the punishment happen?
Along the way.
Along the way, after the faithful are removed. In other words, you could see how, why are you here on earth? What's your purpose? You being faithful to the Lord are restraining the planet, literally. People are being driven by their selfishness, and we want to shine a light and say, hey, that's not going to lead to happiness. And the presence of godly people on earth helps restrain that. So you can see it's God's mercy in a way. You know, Mary, she dies. I'll tell you the story soon. But she's in heaven, and they say, you've got to go back. She says, no, I'm right, thanks. I don't want to go back. I've got four little children. I love it. I'm in unconditional love. No, you've got to go back. And they give her a laundry list of things that she has to achieve. And one of them is about telling people about how trustworthy God is, how really trustworthy God really is, and how he's got it under control. This idea. So, you know, we need to be here. Faithful people need to be here. It keeps our... let's internalize it. Inside me, there is things that are good, and there are things that are not. The things that are good inside me are keeping the things that are not in check. And if they were to be separated too quickly, I'd run headlong into hell. I would run headlong into hell. And I have no one to blame, not God, just me. So this idea that you know, God in some ways wants to keep us in check, but it's about this quality of faithfulness. So let's have a look at the definition of what faithfulness is. Do you want to run through it there for us, faithfulness? The dictionary definition.
Okay. Strict or thorough in the performance of duty, true to one's word, promises and vows, steady in allegiance or affection, loyal, constant, reliable, trusted or believed, accurate.
Beautiful. They're nice qualities that we would want to have, but what do they mean when we think about God? God is able to be trusted or believed. God is accurate. You know, God is strict in taking care of us, in not dropping us, and not neglecting us, not letting one hair fall out of our head without him knowing about it. There's that idea of faithfulness. Synonyms, do you want to go through those, Ken?
Synonyms. Loyalty, devotion, fidelity, constancy, dependability, trustworthiness, fealty, and adherence.
Nice. Fealty, that kind of making a pledge of allegiance, that pledging yourself to be faithful in a situation. You know, when life throws those curveballs and your fight flight kicks in and you just want to go the easy way, I've had a terrible week, I think we'll just hit the bottle. No. Your values kick in. Your values about health, your values about being showing other people in your life the right way, the way to handle things. Nothing wrong with a social drink, but your values say, no, there are better ways to handle this. How about I have a quiet bath, spend some time meditating on the good things in my life, being grateful. Maybe read a passage, put some song on that can help calm me. You know, it's your values that push you that direction when your biology says, oh, I need a quick fix. Pop a Valium or drink something or whatever. You know, I mean, humans have found multiple ways to ease the stress in their life instead of letting the values lead us into a better path. So synonyms like fealty, yes, and loyalty and devotion. The antonyms are interesting too. Disloyalty, treachery, disregard, inconstancy. So when you aren't constant, you know, you go along well for a while and then someone's relying on you and you're not there, you didn't let them know. Unfaithfulness.
but just being inconsistent in your own values. Now, this is why I say this virtue above every other touches every area of your life. Dishonesty and falseness. Now, let's go back to this idea about, you know, the fundamental idea that God sends people to hell, that he punishes them, right? That is contrary to the idea of God's faithfulness, totally. Mary, she's a doctor, she's a spine surgeon. 1999, she's down in Chile, South Chile, in a very remote place, riding rapids with her husband and a number of other people. She's a very experienced kayaker. She knows what she's doing. This day, her husband had a sore back, and he decided to sit out in the sun and do some reading, and she's traveling with these people that she didn't know that well. And she just knew, at a certain point, she just knew something was going wrong. You could feel it in your bones. She could just feel she wasn't handling this water right. And she got to a point where she went over one of those drops, and she hit hard, the boat turned upside down, and she got caught in an area, and the water was pushing so hard she couldn't get out of the boat. Her legs were broken. And she said, "God, I commit my life into your hands." Just came out of her. Now, she'll tell you that she was brought up by Christians, she was made to go to church. Then when she went to college to study to become a doctor, she kind of just left that behind. I mean, if people ask, she'd say, "Oh, I'm a Christian." But it wasn't really her world. She said, "I took on the religion of the intellect when I went to uni. That's what my world, my religion became, the intellect." And she studied and became a really amazing doctor. But she did occasionally take her children to church to teach them morals. She thought, that'll be a good place to get some morals, you know? Her life was not connected to church or God in any way at all. Yet in this moment, but she did believe in being a good person. Her and her husband, not churchgoers, just believed to live a good life, be a good person. Now in this moment that she's underwater, water is pressing her against the boat so she couldn't even get a kayak, she couldn't even get herself out. She felt, she said, "Jesus, hug her." She said she knew it was Christ. Hug her. She said, "I didn't experience oxygen hunger." You know that terrible feeling when you're underwater and you desperately want a breath of air? She said, "I felt none of that. I couldn't even feel my legs were broken." She said, "I just felt this incredible peace. And he said to me, if you live or die, it's okay. Live or die, your children will be okay, your husband will be okay." She just felt this incredible love and peace. Now, she ended up being underwater 30 minutes. 30 minutes. There's no way she was alive. When they finally found her and pulled her out, her colleagues, and began resuscitation, she was dead. But her experience was she was underwater, being hugged by the Lord, talked to by the Lord. Next thing she knew, she was going off and with a crowd of people who she said, they weren't angels, they were people, but they were loved ones. But she didn't know who they were. She hadn't lost anybody by that stage in her life. But she knew they were connected to her somehow, her whole life, and they were loving on her, and they took her for a short tour. Well, she said it felt like hours to her, but she went on a tour and saw things and they talked to her. On the way to this experience, she kept hearing her colleagues say, "Mary, come back, Mary, breathe." She'd say to these people, "Hold a minute." She'd go back to her body, hop in it, breathe, and then it'd become a corpse again. And this happened, she said, 5-6 times. She was just trying to give this person, they weren't a believer or anything, they were just another kayaker saying, "Come back, breathe, breathe," resuscitation. She'd come back, she'd breathe, and then she'd die. So this happened after 30 minutes of being underwater, and then she had her experience of being in heaven, and there came a point, she said, we came to this beautiful dome building, and one of the leaders, like the leader of this group, turned to me and said, "You must go back." And she said, "No, I'm not going back. I'm home. This is home. And I'm finally feeling that unconditional love that I've always wanted." But she was told, "No, you've got to go back." And she agreed, and they gave her a list, burnt it into her mind, a list of things that she needed to do on earth. That was over 20 years ago, and she's still out there sharing this experience with people. Now, I'm highlighting this to emphasize the faithfulness of God. Juxtaposed to this idea that you better know Jesus, you better pray to him now, or you're in trouble. We just know in the new church that it's not quite like that. It doesn't quite work that way. God is faithful even if we aren't. That's how it works. And this woman believed in being a good person. And that was enough for the Lord to get a hold of her life. He's got a hold of her now, though. I mean, you can't shut her up about the love of Jesus and how trustworthy he is. But she can clearly see the recognition in her life where she was not seeking God. So let's move on here. Let's have a look at these quotes about faithfulness. Starting with the Buddha. Health is the greatest gift. Contentment, the greatest wealth. Faithfulness, the best relationship. When you're true to your values, you have internal rewards. Well, you don't have that immediacy of going with the pleasure of the moment, but you have internal rewards that stay with you and comfort you. You know, whether it's infidelity, whether it's stealing, lying, cheating, you know, we know the 10. Whatever it is that pulls at you, a curveball comes and says, oh, this would get you out of trouble. And your values kick in and you choose them, there is intrinsic, ongoing reward. Faithfulness is the best relationship. Edward Lewis Cole, your faithfulness makes you trustworthy to God. How about that, flipping that on its head? God's trustworthy, are you? He goes on to another quote, I liked it so much I put this one in too. Being faithful in that which is another man's qualifies us to receive our own. That's actually an almost direct quote of scripture, which we will look at in a moment when we get to the scriptural parts. Nothing is more noble, nothing more venerable than fidelity. Faithfulness and truth are the most sacred excellences and endowments of the human mind. Marcus Tullius Cicero. How do you say it?
Cicero,
that's right. Cicero, yeah, the S. Thank you, Jordan. Cicero. Latin student over here, on the way to a Latin scholar. Now, when we get to the image of New Church Day of the Lord riding on a horse in white, he's dipped in blood. Now, that blood, people think, fundamentalists tend to think, is because he's coming back with vengeance. The blood is there because we have violated the Word of God. We have made the Word of God say what we want it to say to justify what we want. We've committed violence, and yet he comes for us faithfully, riding on that horse. And it says on the robe, faithful and true. Marcus says the endowment, he says that the most sacred of excellence endowing our mind are faithfulness and truth. Interesting. So let's go to the scriptural quotes now. Would you like Ken there to go into Deuteronomy 7:9?
Deuteronomy 7:9. Now therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations.
Notice the words there, he keeps his covenant with them that love him. It means he's able to bless abundantly those that are loving him. But what about those that don't know him and haven't had the chance to love him? Well, he keeps his commandments to them for 1,000 generations. What's a generation? 20, 40, 70, depending on your interpretation of generation, years? Everyone has a different interpretation. It's a long time that God's going to... Because of you, 1,000 generations of your descendants are going to experience the blessings of God, or the commandments of God being kept in their life. Psalm, you want to read that one for us, Psalm 33?
Psalm 33, verse 4. For the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth.
Yes, that's beautiful. The word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth. So true. He is able to be trusted. You know, we get a curveball, go back to what the Lord says to do. Trust him, you will not regret it. Jeremiah 31, 3 and 4. The Lord has appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore with loving kindness have I drawn thee. Again I will build thee. Thou shalt be built, O Virgin of Israel. Thou shalt again be adorned with thy tabrets, and shall go forth in the dances of them that make merry. Well, I just can't help but hear New Jerusalem in that. You know, we've gone astray. We've lost the Garden of Eden. We're going to get the garden back with the city of God as well. Matthew 25, 23. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. And flowing on from that same idea, Luke 16:10, he that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. Just stop there for a moment. If you can be faithful in the smallest of things, you'll make it in the big ones. If you can trust God in the little things, like you're running late, it's a traffic jam, you'll be able to trust him in the big things of life. Think about that. And then he goes on to say, he that is unjust in the least, he's going to mess it up and be unjust in the big things too. Little things matter, don't they? Tell our children they don't matter. Little things matter. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon or money, who will commit to you the trust of true riches? What's true riches there? What's the Lord really getting at, true riches? What do you reckon he might be hitting at?
Values.
Say again, Ian.
Values.
Values? I like that. True riches are values. Wow, that's an excellent answer, Ian. That's great. I was actually thinking more about the heavenly proprium. We get to have a heavenly sense of self. But that really is what values are, Ian. Yeah. You beautifully said, values. If you can't be trusted with money, how can God give you his very soul? What is eternal life? What are you? You are a spark from the divine flame. What is eternal life? That spark grows into something incredible, an eternal flame. A small, finite, eternal flame, but eternal nonetheless. And that's the life of God. You are receiving. How can God trust you with his very soul if he can't trust you with a bit of money or whatever money represents in that thing? And then he goes on to say, if you have not been faithful with that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? There's your heavenly ego, your own, yourself. How can he give you your own? Beautiful stuff. Really challenging, but beautiful. And 1 Thessalonians, do you want to read that one, Ken, for us? 5:24.
Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it.
Okay, faithful is he who calls you to do it. So you're feeling like things are going south, or the ball's curving and your eyes are blurring and your hands are sweating and you're going to drop the bat and it's curving. Look to the Lord. Somehow he's going to make that bat and ball connect. And when it hits and you hear that noise and it sails out, you'll know it wasn't you. But the challenge is, the ball's curving, your eyes are blurring, your hands are sweating. What do? We go into fight or flight. Instead of going to the Lord, go to the Lord, look to the Lord. He who is faithful will finish it. He wouldn't ask you to do it unless he will provide and make you help you do it. Revelation 19:11, and I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. He that sat upon him was called faithful and true, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. Not war against us, not fighting against humans, fighting against the things in your life that have stopped you from being who you want to be. Let's have a look on the back at a little bit of explanation of that last one. He who sat on it, Apocalypse revealed 8:12, he who sat on it, that is on the white horse, means the Lord in relation to the Word. How do I know what to do in life? The Word. What value should I take on? The Word. When I'm questioning, go back to the Word. So in regard to the man sitting on this horse, it's the Lord in relation to the Word. That is the Lord in relation to the Word. It is apparent from verse 13 below, where we are told that he was clothed with a garment stained with blood. I've told you what that means. It means that we've made the Word say things it shouldn't say. And that his name is called the Word of God. Written on it was also faithful and true. And this symbolizes, get a hold of this, divine goodness and divine truth. Faithfulness symbolizes divine goodness, because divine goodness is faithful. So there's the answer we've been looking for. Remember I said at the beginning of the morning, what is faithfulness? Is it, you know, being true to your values? Yes, but it is so much more. And we in the New Church talk about the difference between faith
and well, doctrine and love, faith and love, good and truth, we differentiate them. But in heaven, you can't separate them. In fact, goodness is called full of faith. I'll read it again. Faithfulness symbolizes divine goodness because divine goodness is faithful. Faithful. What does it mean to be faithful? It means to be filled with God's goodness. Wow. And we know that God unconditionally loves us. He's not looking to get his own. In reference to people, someone who is faithful is someone who is someone in the innermost or third heaven. Thus, someone prompted by celestial goodness, as seen in paragraph 744. Now, as I said before, faithfulness of all the virtues is the what? Do you remember the word I used?
Key.
Key was one word. What was the other word?
Core.
Sorry?
Core
is another good word. You're good at this. Come on. The crown of all virtues. It's the ruling virtue. When you have faithfulness in your life, you will stick to the other virtues where you're a bit weak and wobbly. Why? Because you have that value in your life of faithfulness, isn't it? So say after me, Lord,
Lord.
You alone
are good.
Help me, Lord,
to be filled
with your goodness
and to become more faithful.
In the little things,
and in the big things.
Now just turn with me and let's say the meditation together. The meditation statement. Together.
I choose to be a faithful partner and friend to all, especially for those I am called to serve. I feel and display affection for my duty. I commit to being a loving, truthful person. I hold strongly to my convictions while looking to the Lord for support. I am thankful, Lord, for the gift of faithfulness. It keeps me on the course to your habitation, even through the storms of life.
So we turn to the very, very back. Let's finish with this focus for the month. This month, let's seek to show those that you love and that you serve how important they are to you. Find a special way to show them your appreciation and your commitment to the relationship that you share. This month, think about that. Well, I hope I've done a good job to drive home to you how important this virtue is above every other virtue. There are times where we feel like compromising a little bit in something small. I'll go so far as to wanting to take a pen back that wasn't mine.
Oh, well.
I think it's important. So come, Millie, let's pray. Let's close in prayer as we thank Lord for this faithful giving that people have done. Lord, you truly are faithful in ways we will never understand. Lord, for those that don't know you yet, you are faithful to reach out and you will find a way to make them welcome in your eternal heaven. Help us, Lord, to improve in areas where maybe we've been slack in little things. Provoke our conscience. Convict us and let us act more faithfully, Lord. And Lord, we thank you for this offering here. It's a simple token back of your true faithfulness towards us. Amen. Amen. So, technically, we're not allowed to mingle, but feel free. I'm going to put this song on as a quiet meditation one more time, just quietly. As we close the service, feel free to just say hi to someone and then we'll make steps towards our next meeting, the family service. Hopefully we can encourage people to come. We've got everything we need here to keep people safe. No one's at risk here. If you are unwell, well, obviously, stay home for your safety and for that of others.